Won't you please be seated? Great is thy faithfulness, is Lamentations chapter 3, verse 23, as we have there in the front of our bulletin, and certainly God is faithful to us, and he continues to be faithful as we seek him. What we're to be doing is we're starting a new book, but you notice we're starting at chapter 3 of the Gospel of Matthew, as we're to be leaving the first part, the Christmas story, for Christmas, as we'll be in Matthew for a while. So we'll pick up the first two chapters next December as we study it. As we, of course, we look at this, this is the story declaring the King Jesus, and as he's written basically to the Jewish nation, with that in mind, it really highlights a lot of the, well, it's filled with prophecies concerning the Old Testament, the coming of the Messiah. As we open it up in verse 1, in those days, that is in the days Jesus was here, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness, and wilderness of Judea, down by the Jericho River near the area called Emmaus. And he was saying, repent, for the kingdom of God, or kingdom of heaven, is at hand. The kingdom of heaven, of course, is a reference where a rule where God has whatever he rules over. And certainly it's the rule of heaven on here upon earth, what he's referred to. The kingdom of heaven will be when the earth is really experienced the rule of Jesus Christ upon this earth. Right now, we're underneath the prince and power of the earth right now, which is controlled by what? It's controlled by Satan. We see the effects of it, but there is going to be a day where Jesus is going to rule. And of course, the kingdom of heaven rules. If he rules in your heart, even this day, this morning, you're experiencing the kingdom of heaven. It's like the earnest of your inheritance is the Holy Spirit is in you. You get that glimpse and that experience with him. But can you imagine what it's going to be like if you remove all the things that hinder, you know, the world, the flesh, and the devil? You get those out of the way, and you're able to enjoy life the way God intended for us to enjoy. And I'm looking forward to it. First thing that he tells us, he says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was really, that was John the Baptist who's spoken by the prophet Isaiah. So again, this is a fulfillment of prophecy right from the beginning that we see the prophet Isaiah, which said, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. You know, of course, that's something you'd have to go back a ways to really to understand that saying, to make his path straight. When a king was coming into a territory, they would go all out, you know, to make sure that he would have a straight path to where he was going. And of course, what they would do is they would do a lot of road work. We're experiencing that, a lot of road work here at Orange County, don't we? And they would have these tremendous building projects because the king has come in, and so they would make the, you know, instead of all the curves, they would cut through the hills, make the straight road, and fill all the potholes and everything else. And really, the king is coming. He says, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And he says in the same John in verse 4, had his raiment of camel's hair and leather girdle about his loins, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Oh, my, what a guy, right? You know, see, of course, just what he was wearing, his raiment was camel's hair. Have you ever petted a camel? You're like, oh, I want like a nice soft kitty. Or you don't do that to camels. You know, their fur is something nice. Fur hair is not that nice to be around, but yet he wore that. And he ate this locust and wild honey. And they think that locust is actually a word for the carob bean, which is really comes off the Joshua tree that they were eating, not necessarily a grasshopper. But he was the first outdoorsman that we have recorded in history. That he loved it, his life that he was living. And so there went out from him in verse 5, from Jerusalem, all of Judea and the regions about Jordan. And so John was out in the wilderness, and he was preaching, and everybody was hearing about it, and they were coming to him, and they were, and he says, and they were baptized by Jordan, and they confessed their sins. And so they would find John the Baptist, and they heard that, and they wanted to come and get right with God. And so they would basically confess their sins, and they were baptized, which is a beautiful picture here. And of course, this is baptism is different than what the Christians identify in baptism. It was calling people for a repentance and a change, basically, the Old Testament baptism. You're identifying with that your life was going to change, and interesting enough, when you're baptized in the River of Jordan was sort of a death of the old life, and that's kind of what the River of Jordan really was a type of, is the really saying goodbye and dying to the old life. Well, it's similar in a sense to Christianity, is because when you're baptized I baptized people in the River Jordan before. Jan and Larry are here. I baptize them. But normally I take a look at the river and I pat it a little bit. And it says, look at this. This is the same water that Jesus was baptized. Isn't this amazing? And then I says, when you go down under the water, when I baptize you, you're saying goodbye to the old man. And then when you come up again, you're being rise again into the newness of life that we have in Christ. And so as you see that, as it's spelled out by Paul in Romans chapter 6, a beautiful picture of baptism. So we see John down there baptizing people. And he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees come to his baptisms. Oh, my goodness. Right now, we're introduced to these guys, as we talked before about them when we were in the book of John, where the Pharisees and the Sadducees were really, they were, you know, troublemakers all the way from the beginning. The Pharisees were the religious sect, basically. They would they kept the Mosaic law, and of course they had this, really what they refer to as the Talmud, where if you ever hear that reference, was really interpretation of what they thought scriptures were all about. And they wrote volumes and volumes and volumes of books. It would line this whole wall of what their interpretation of what the law was about and what they thought it meant. And I love what Jesus said about these guys. They were so much into the regulations. Jesus said, they strain in a gnat, but they swallow a camel. You know, they were so concerned about, you know, how you should pour your tea, basically, and how you should eat your bread, and the different things that you did to make sure it was right before God, but yet their hearts certainly wasn't. The Sadducees, on the other hand, were just simply the materialistic of the day. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in an afterlife, but they liked wearing religious garb and liked the prestige that it brought. And isn't it so sad today that there's people that stand in the pulpit, they don't believe in heaven? They don't believe in eternal life and all that, but yet they, some way or another, I don't quite understand their mindset, but yet that's what they did, is they wanted that position, per se, and they would wear these long robes and have all the beads. Maybe you've seen them in the prayer shawls and everything they have, but they have no consciousness of the living God. And so what did John the Baptist say to these guys as they were coming down for Jerusalem? And they said, we want to, what did he say? Look at verse 7 as he goes on. He says, and he said unto them, these people, he says, O generation of vipers, you bunch of snakes, who have warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth fruit, therefore, that demonstrates repentance. I like to look at this for a moment, because here he's talking about two times already we saw, repentance that John here is talking about. The fruit of repentance is otherwise the evidence of a change, the proof of repentance. This is the first words that God had spoken now for 400 years that we have recorded in the Bible, since the book of Malachi until John the Baptist here is speaking. And I think it's very interesting. In verse 2, he says, repent. And now he's telling us here once again, as we see here in verse 7, he tells them that once again to repent. And what does it mean to repent? One definition simply means a change in mind, or you're changing, you're feeling remorse about the things that you're doing. Well, I know a lot of people that change their mind, but they go on, continue living like they always have lived. But of course, that's not biblical repentance. Real repentance is being sorry that you never, and that you'll never ever do it again. There's evidence that of change within your life, and repentance really is the first steps of salvation. That you are, it's like you're going so far away from God that I like to call repentance simply means a U-turn. Like I was trying to go to Los Angeles, but I started headed south on the 5 freeway, and I get down to San Clemente, and I says, oh, I'm not quite getting to Los Angeles, am I? So I need to make a U-turn and get back on the right course. And repentance is that, is you're making a U-turn back to the Lord. And if we find ourselves off track as believers, what are we supposed to do but to repent, make that U-turn, return back to the Lord? You know, when you, on a day of Pentecost, as we get into the book of Acts, the people were really convicted by the preaching of Peter, and they inquired to Peter. Remember, they said, Peter, what should we do? As he was preaching to those thousands, and he says, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. The first word of the gospel is always repent. The first sign that you look at somebody really has changed is you see a repentance in a person's life. The scripture declares that godly sorrow worketh repentance, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. There's two types of sorrow he talks about in the scriptures. There's godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. Godly sorrow certainly would be something that you want a remorse and you feel that something that got between you and your walk with the Lord, but the worldly sorrow doesn't necessarily dictate a change within a person's life. It's interesting when Jesus wrote to the 7 churches in Asia, and as you look at the book of Revelation, what does he tell the 5 of the 7 churches? He says this is, I think, should be very alarming to the churches. He tells them all these 5 is what? Is to repent, is to turn back from God. They have drifted so far away from the Lord that they were going through the motions of a church, but they weren't really walking with God. That to me is something I always should pay attention in my own life, that I'm walking that spiritual life the way God would have me to live, not a phony life, but rather a true life where I'm walking in repentance. So verse 8, John is calling the people to bring forth fruit that would demonstrate true repentance. That's exactly what the Lord wants to see, was fruit. Fruit that will demonstrate in your life that you really have come to the Lord and that you renounce that sin and you have forsaken it. There's a certain precaution that needs to be taken when once you realize that you have a problem in an area that this change has taken over. Somebody has a problem with alcohol and they say that they repent. You won't find them necessarily walking in the bars, will you? There's some precautions that you're going to do. Problems with guys that have problems with women. They're going to keep themselves in a place of holiness and walk away from places where they have might stumble or fall. People who have a trouble playing the dice, playing cards, won't be heading up the freeway on their way to Vegas, will they? They'll keep themselves from those areas of temptation and trials. Because true repentance means I'm going to stay away also. I'm going to fortify myself. Another fruit of repentance you see, is a broken and a contrite heart. David said, you do not want sacrifices of offering in Psalm 51. He says, but a broken and contrite spirit you will not despise. True repentance will always deal with our inner man. It deals with that brokenness where we want the Lord and we want we want to make sure, I think one of the things I see is I see myself in the light of God, and that brings me to a place of repentance. You know, the sacrifice of offerings without a true repentance is worthless. Prayer without repentance is deceptiveness already, as we talked about earlier. And we read in the scriptures, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear my prayers. That's kind of a scary verse, isn't it? If I've not come clean with the Lord and I regard iniquity in my heart, and it doesn't describe what that sin could be. It could be all kinds of different things. Angry at your brother, you know, or whatever it might be, lustful thoughts or anything. If I harbor in my heart, he says it's like my access to heaven's been blocked until I come to the place of repentance and confessing my need for forgiveness. Then once I do it, John tells us that he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Isn't that beautiful? It's almost like, sometimes we get this wrong thinking that I got to do a lot of different things in order to get right with God when I make a mistake and I blow it. All he wants us to do is to come to him. He says, if I confess my sins, he's faithful and just to forgive me and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. It tells us in Isaiah 59:1, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that he cannot save, neither his ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hid his face that he cannot hear. He says it's our iniquity that separates us where God can't hear our prayers. He goes on in Isaiah 1:15, when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. When you make many prayers, I will not hear. What is thy problem? The hand is full of blood. And finally in Jeremiah 14:12, when they fast, I will not hear their cry. When they offer burnt offering and oblations, I will not accept them. And that's when we regard iniquity in our hearts. What brings forth true repentance? What brings forth true repentance? Paul tells us it's the goodness of God that leads a man to repentance. When I think of God's grace, the work of God for me at Calvary, it truly brings me to repentance. Yeah, I've been thinking here the last few days that, my goodness, it won't be long before we'll be behind this building and we'll be celebrating on a Good Friday, the Easter weekend, as we look at the work of Jesus upon the cross as we do our Good Friday service. The goodness of God always leads me to the cross of Calvary. That even while I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me. And that he loves me. And that brings me to a place I want to come to him and say, Lord, I'm a sinful man. Would you please forgive me? And he says automatically, he says, yes, I do. He's just looking for us to come. I need to know that God loves me. Do you know that God loves you this morning? And that he'll forgive me if I just come to him. I need to know that God can work a change in my life. He could change me. I don't have to be the same person. I won't be the same person today as the Lord tarries a year from now, because I'm going to be more like Christ as day by day. You ever notice how the Lord chips away at your heart, your life? He's changing us in order that we might be more like him as we yield to him, as we seek him out. And sometimes those changes hurt because we hold on to this old life. He could change my desire or give me the power over my desire. He could change your desire. I a few years ago, I was diagnosed with a problem, a kidney problem per se, that I've been battling and all that. And I had a little bit of the eating problems. I never saw a donut I couldn't eat, right? And I would eat every sweet thing or anything that, you get a steak, make sure there's a lot of fat on it. You know, everything that you're not supposed to eat, I was on that thing. And Misa, my wife, and I prayed about it. And within a day or so, my whole diet changed. My whole appetite changed. I go, what happened to that? Now I get excited when I get a bowl of fruit. You know, if I got, oh boy, we got vegetables today, you know? And that's the thing, is that he can change my desires. He can change your desires as you seek him, because he wants to bless his children. And that's the part that we think that we you know, that God loves you far more than you can ever imagine. God loves you greater than I could explain, because he's your child. I mean, not he's your child, you're his child. But correct that, in case people look at that later on down the road. I'm awareness of the really the horrible consequences of my sin. Doesn't sin always kind of, like, man, why did I do that? There's always consequences. There's hurt, there's pain that comes forth from it, but yet there's forgiveness. The prophet, when facing David concerning his sin, declared, remember when Nathan the prophet came to David after he not only had sinned with Bathsheba, but you know, had Uriah, has, you know, really had put him to death, Uriah, Bathsheba's husband. He says, you have cause, Nathan said, you have given great cause for the enemies, the Lord, to blaspheme. And it discredits the gospel of Jesus Christ when at one moment we're saying that we live for Christ and the other moment we're living after our flesh. It discredits our witness for Jesus Christ to realize that your sin may be responsible for giving people to not to accept Jesus Christ. That's a horrible thought. If I want to be a Christian, if that's what's supposed to be what Christianity is all about, I don't want to be like you because I see how you live your life. And not saying that any of us are perfect, because we all make mistakes and we all kind of, you know, go off the handle or do things that are wrong. But as we demonstrate God's forgiveness, and as we, you know, as we practice the things that God tells us that we should do, I think one of the amazing verses is in the book of Colossians chapter 3, where Paul writes, he says, to believers, and this is always important, he's writing to believers, and he says, if you have a quarrel against any, otherwise there's a squabble, could be between husband and wife, it could be between work relationship, it could be within the church. He says, if you have a quarrel against any, even as Christ has forgiven you, so do ye. He says the standard that we should live our life is what Jesus does for our lives. He forgives. And how does he forgive? He forgives us totally and completely, and he remembers our sins no more. I like that. He says, put that in practice, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, even when we make mistakes, God can use our mistakes for his glory, for his witness. These are the things that we're to take to heart, will bring, you know, will, you know, really change our life, you know, and I think it's so interesting where godly sorrow worketh repentance. But you know something? You could write on a chalkboard 100 times that you're not going to do something. But if there isn't true repentance, guess what? You'll do it. True repentance will manifest by completely ceasing the sin, by a change within your life. He goes on. Notice in verse 9. I don't think to say within yourself, we have Abraham our fathers. Remember, who is he speaking to? These religious leaders. He says, they were boasting that they're descendants of Abraham. And I say, well, we find people boasted today. He said, well, I used to go to Calvary Chapel. You know, I sat underneath Pastor Chuck. Or, you know, I went to this movement. I was underneath the Pentecostal movement. You know, unless it changes your life and you know Jesus Christ personally, it doesn't matter. Jesus is, our relationship with God is always individual. It should change us as individuals. He says, we think that we have our descendants, that you were descendants of Abraham. They're trusting that for their salvation. They were looking for really a generational type of salvation, because I'm related to Abraham, I'm saved. I remember growing up in the Presbyterian church as I was a young man, not young man, young kid. I remember the great day when I was called in front of the church and they gave me a Bible. And they said, now I'm part of the Presbyterian Church. And I had no idea what it meant, but I had a Bible. I put it on a shelf, and I thought, oh, that's the Holy Bible. Never read the thing, but I was part of the church. But that's kind of their mentality, where they felt like, I'm a Jew. I'm a Pharisee. I'm a Sadducee. I'm part of the kingdom of God. But yet they were so far. It's foolish to think of that, because you're a citizen of the United States, you're saved, and that's where a lot of people in our country believe that. Don't say that we have Abraham as our father. Verse 9, for I say unto you that God is able of these stones to rise up children unto Abraham. I think that's so funny how here it is, John the Baptist talking about this. Later on, Jesus speaks about how he could rise people out of those stones. When I've been over to Israel, I've looked at those stones. I says, I wonder if these stones could actually talk. As you see the reference being made out of here. He says, now the time is when the axe is laid at the root of the tree. Therefore, every tree which brings not forth good fruit will be cut down and cast in the fire. John chapter 14, excuse me, John chapter 15, Jesus talks about our lives bearing fruit. And if we don't bear fruit, that we will, as Christians, will be cut down and cast in the fire. But here he's talking about the nation of Israel, these religious leaders, that he says, when the axe is laid to the root of the tree, therefore the tree will be that brings not good fruit will be cut down. You know, as you look at this, unfortunately, that did happen. Remember, this is probably, 30 AD or so. And it wasn't very many years later, from 70 AD, a Roman general named Titus came marching into Jerusalem. And prior to that, they thought they were the cat's meow. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, they thought nothing would ever change to them, that they had their act together all through the life of Jesus. You'll see that they feel like they're in power, they're in control. And here what John was saying, you better repent, because there's going to come a time where the axe is going to be laid at the root of the tree. You're going to get wiped out. 70 AD, Titus came in and completely destroyed Jerusalem. And it was destroyed, you know what? What's not there anymore? It's the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They're gone. They're out of history. He given them a time, and he says, you need to repent. You need to return back to God. He says, don't you know that the time is clicking? I don't know about you, but it seems like time's going by real fast in my life. My goodness, like I said to you last week, I keep thinking I'm 38 years old, but I looked in the mirror. The mirrors are the worst invention on the face of the planet, because I looked in the mirror and go, uh-oh, what happened? I got a little older. But the fact is that now is the time of repentance. Not tomorrow. Who knows how many tomorrows do we actually have in our life? But to live for God today. To live with all of our, Jesus said it so simply, and I think it's so beautiful for us to finish up on this note, and we'll pick up the story, and we'll finish verse 11 and chapter 3 next week. Jesus just simply says that what he requires of us is to love the Lord thy God with all of our heart, all of our soul, and all of our might, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. He says, if we could do anything that pleases God, if we just did that, the best that we can. You mean that, Terry, that I need to be perfect? No, God didn't say that. That I tried my best each and every day is to put Jesus first, to live for him. Get up in the morning and say, Lord, I got this going on, that going on. Commit my day, our daily, our walk unto the Lord as we pray in the morning. And then just try to do things that are pleasing to him throughout the day. If we do that, we do well. Unfortunately, there are those who deceive themselves, like the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They'll walk in their own religious pride, and they refuse to repent. If we just simply humble ourselves before the Lord each and every day, say, Lord, I need you even this day to help me. Our Heavenly Father will never ever say no to us, but he'll be there to help us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much. Thank you for a beautiful time of worship. Lord, thank you for a time in your word. Lord, what strong words that John gave to those who would listen that day. Lord, we know that there were those who came with honest hearts and were baptized and repented. Those who were coming down from Jerusalem, maybe the guy that made carts for a living, maybe the baker, maybe the housewives, as they would come and hear John and they would repent. And we just thank you, Lord, that even with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, there were those who did repent, as we will know certainly of Nicodemus. He certainly did. He came to know you as Lord and Savior. Father, I just pray that if there's anybody who's been fighting with you, anybody who's been struggling with maybe anger, disappointment, and really not coming to you, that maybe they're harboring bitterness in their hearts, Lord, that they won't really gum up the dam, per se, and that really stops the flow of blessing upon their lives, Lord, that they would just simply ask you for forgiveness. They would come clean with you and once again feel that flow of the Holy Spirit moving in their lives, Father. And we just thank you again for the words of John the Baptist here this morning. And may we all take heed. In Jesus' name, amen.